From anime3000.com, it's the Anime 3000 panel with Sean Russell. Each week we focus on a different topic pertaining to the wide world of anime and manga, and bring you a panel of diverse perspectives on that topic. And now, Sean Russell.
In this week's episode, our panel gives us a comprehensive look into the world of giant robots. This episode was designed to give the average otaku a glimpse into the mind of a giant robot fan. What shows should they watch? Why are some creators more influential than others? And most importantly, who is Go Nagai? Our topics include Yasuhiro Imagawa, Yoshiyuki Tomino, Go Nagai and Ken Ishikawa, Shoji Kawamori, as well as others. They will also give us their top picks at the end of the show. Our panel this week includes Gerald from Anime World Order, John Paul from the Fight Bait Anime Podcast, Mike Dent from R5 Central, as well as a special surprise guest during the show. Welcome once again to the Anime 3000 panel. I'm Sean Russell, your moderator and host. Let's meet this week's panel. Our first panelist is one of the hosts of the extremely popular Anime World Order podcast. He's a huge fan of giant robots, 80s anime, and Japanese video games. Let's welcome Gerald to our show.
Hey, how's everybody doing?
Our second panelist is no stranger to our podcast and usually finds the time to put out several weekly podcasts over at his website, fightbait.com. John Paul is on our program.
Word.
Our third panelist runs the Japanese pop culture podcast R5 Central. He's also a contributor for the popular anime magazine Otaku USA. Let's meet Mike Den.
Otherwise known as the Great Sage Eagle of Heaven, master of the 17 of Mind Transformations, Hot Blood Everlasting, the Invincible Dream of Flames, and apparently I'm having an epic tongue malfunction.
Pretty much, Dom, just for our listeners, to let you know, a couple of weeks back, we started talking about giant robots. We had a long conversation about Gundam. I had no idea what anyone was talking about. I kind of kept my mouth quiet, and I'm glad I did that. But I had a chance to watch a few shows that were recommended to me, you know, the three Gundam movies, a few shows from Go Nagai, this, that, and the other. And I wanted to do this show for people who are in the same boat as I am that want to get into giant robots, but they don't know where to start. So each topic that we're going to go over, our panel, they're going to tell you a little bit about each of these creators and directors. So our first topic is Yasuhiro Imagawa. So who wants to start off and just telling us a little bit about this creator? What are some of the shows that they've created, or in this case, some of the shows that he's directed, and pretty much its significance to giant robots?
From what I can understand, Imagawa's actually been doing giant robots kind of since the beginning. He actually worked on Dunbine.
And he also worked on Zabungle, too, as a, I guess...
Zabunguru! Yes.
Yeah, as like a episode director as well.
I'm glad you've got the same ANN page pulled up that I
know. Exactly. Yeah, and he worked on your favorite show of all time, Gerald, Zeta Gundam.
Oh, jeez. I guess we'll talk about that when we get to Tomino.
Be ready for that one. But I have to give him props because everyone knows him for that and for like his various works. But like the ones that stand out, Giant Robo, of course, one of the best OVAs of all time. But he also did do work on Mobile Fighter G Gundam. And
the interesting thing with Giant Robo is, and I'm a very sort of all over the map place with Imagawa. Some of his work I love. Some of his work I think is some of the best stuff in anime. And some of his work I hate and despise. And Giant Robo is one that I love a lot, and there was a lot of passion put into that, to the point where they started making Giant Robo in, 1992 or so?
Like, 1982, 1993.
92 or so, and they finished it in, 1997 or 8?
Like, yes, 97.
97? I mean, that is a long time for 7 episodes. There was a long break in between for G Gundam, I believe. Entirely for G Gundam.
Which also was worth it.
A lot of passion for that work.
And what exactly is it about Giant Robo that everyone seems to love?
Take your pick. I mean, if it isn't the story, it's the animation. If it's not the animation, it's the beautiful score and like the music and
why don't you sing that for us
you mean the Ode to Gunbuster? Let me explain this. For an episode of Ninja Consultants, they were talking about what next giant robot show should be watched for another episode or something like that. And everyone was freaking out and going like crazy over Gunbuster. So I was like, all right, instead of just saying Gunbuster like 20 times in a paragraph, I was like, all right, well, I'll just be clever and I'll do a little song out of it. And we did a little track called Ode to Gunbuster, which I'll send to you, Sean. It's pretty epic, but it's set to the second ending theme of Giant Robo. Like, well, there's no set ending theme, but it's like for the episode 2 ending suite, if you want to call it that. But yeah,
Giant Robo is one of those weird cases where it's just a combination of a lot of good things all in one show. It's a very sort of rare thing.
Yeah, the Mitsutero Yokoyama encyclopedia, if you will.
Yeah, Mitsutero Yokoyama, I guess, since we're just throwing out names here, he's one of the older, very well-respected anime creators. He's a very dead man right now. And his house
worst way to go out, too.
Yeah, his house lit on fire, but he's the creator of the original Giant Robo. Giant Robo was actually this this TV series that was done in the 60s that everybody hates. And he did Gigantor, and he did some of the earliest magical girl shows, and virtually all the characters in Giant Robo are from series that he did and worked on. And it's just, and it's not required that you know everything, but it adds a lot to it if you do.
Yeah, which, same again, thing could be said accessible. Like the whole thing with Shin Mazinger. That's like that whole argument with that.
Yes.
Where. But yeah, but being Go Nagai, Shin Mazinger is more intense, but I digress.
Which is going to be interesting to talk about because Yasuhiro Imagawa directs Shin Mazinger.
Dun dun dun.
But it's a Go Nagai creation, so when do we bring that up?
Yeah. Yeah, the other thing that's really cool about Imagawa is that he did actually a proper remake of Tetsujin 28.
Yes.
Also did the movie, which I still have yet to see, and I want to see that. But yeah, the Tetsujin 28, like 2004 TV series, is freaking awesome. If only for the fact that he tried to go for an approach where it is definitely post-war. I mean, like the original Tetsujin 28 was post-war, but they never really went into that with like the original TV series or whatever. It was just Monster of the Week and going after guys who may or may not be at the Ku Klux Klan and who were trying to shoot at him with a Tommy gun in the backseat of the car. It's in the opening credits, people, but it all kind of like gets spelled out like in that one episode where all of a sudden this giant robot is attacking Japan, and they're trying to call America to like try and see if they can bomb them. And it's like, what? Like, are you saying that they can bomb us with nukes, but they can't fly out and help us out? Dumb Americans and stuff like that, which I thought was kind of a nice change, as it were, from the status quo that we had always expected from like this kind of squeaky clean Tetsujin 28.
Yeah. Imagawa is a very strange man. I believe Daryl got to have an audience with him. Well, I should say that he had like a panel in Miami that Daryl went to, and I asked him if he was wearing a bandana, and he was. And the only other person that's allowed to wear a bandana is Leiji Matsumoto. So he's right up there.
So this thing is set in stone.
He did do 7 of 7, which is a crappy show.
What would you say were some of his highlights, and what would you say some of the things that you want to stay away from?
I have three things for his highlights. Number one, Giant Robo. Number two, Giant Robo. Number three, Shin Mazinger.
True.
So, and I'm only putting Shin Mazinger as three because it's not finished yet, and it's who knows where it will go. But it's
I'm sure he'll deliver.
It seems it's been delivering pretty well so far. I would definitely go with those.
Let's see, I guess top three for me. So I definitely got a Giant Robo. And then I'm honestly confident that Shin Mazinger is going to actually end well, so I'm going to list that number two. And then it's tough because I want to say G Gundam as like the top one, but people are kind of divided about that. But I do want to also get the word out about the Tetsujin 28 TV series. I hope somebody rescues it because Jenny and I released that. No one snatched it up for a DVD re-release. So that will definitely...
I think it is fair to say with G Gundam that it's a very polarizing series, and you were mentioning that. I think I hate G Gundam a lot, but I know a lot of people that love G Gundam a lot.
Yeah.
So I think it's worth mentioning G Gundam. It's something that you just have to watch on your own and see if it clicks with you or not.
Yeah, yeah. It's basically a Dragon Ball Z if Dragon Ball took over Gundam for an elaborate fanfic, minus the furries.
And lots of plastic wrapped ass.
Of course.
Lots.
And horse as well.
And yeah. I just remember ass.
Well, yeah, well, because you are an ass man, Gerald, and
that is
that's
true.
Why you're so lovable.
So I think with that, we're going to go to the second topic, which is Yoshiyuki Tomino.
Oh, boy.
Oh, boy.
What can we say about him? What can we say that hasn't already been said, aside from him being a butcher?
Tomino is a man who somehow, some way, keeps getting work again and again and again. That's unfair. Yoshiyuki Tomino did fundamentally change how we see giant robot shows. Like, he was doing giant robot shows, and he was doing, like, regular anime for a long, long time, and he really did change giant robot shows a little bit. You saw a little bit of it with Zambot 3 back in the 70s.
Which is, I think, is one of his best works ever.
Zambot 3 is really good. And then he changed it a bit more with, then he blew people away with Gundam, and then he was changing the formula up a bit more with Ideon. This was Gundam was late 70s and Ideon was early 80s. But the one thing that I have to say about Tomino more than anything else is that he is a fantastic producer that happens to be a director.
But he cannot write for crap.
He is a fantastic idea guy. He's the type of guy that needs to be in the boardroom who's saying, okay guys, this is what we need for a show. We need a show about this giant robot that's got the sword that goes into infinity, and it's just amazing, and it's really, really big, and then the entire world ends eventually. Yeah, we need a show like that, and then hand it off to people that can write.
I think that's why Vifom was so successful.
He sounds like my type of guy.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, because, like, Vifom, all he ever did was planning, but then that's, like, regarded as, like, one of the most underrated shows of the 80s, really.
Yeah. And a really good opening. Good opening.
Give us your courage. No.
I remember I was in a panel with the director of Overman King Gainer. And Overman King Gainer is a series that...
awesome.
Well, it's it's a series that Tomino directed. And this was not Tomino in this. This was, I guess, another director of the show. And I actually asked him, you know, is Tomino crazy? Because Tomino has just been known for being just a wacko guy. And he says, he just looks at me and says into the mic, I guess that's the price that comes with being a genius. And he says that Tomino insisted that he works at the office all the time, that he sits right next to him, and that Tomino will suddenly start having an argument that he started 30 years ago with another guy and will want to finish... And we'll want to finish with him right there.
Oh my god. There's actually another fun little story, because there was the mech panel at Anime Central this year, which was an okay panel, but it was actually kind of cool. But one of the guys was talking about how, like, Yoshiyuki Tomino is also kind of crazy. And he came to Chicago a couple of years ago for the premiere of the Zeta Gundam New Translation Trilogy. And... So the day before, they did the kind of an autograph session, but they kept these two guys kept trying to catch him, because they're like, do the monkey dance from King Gainer.
Yeah.
Because there's that gif of him during, like, it's the making of, and he just kind of hops around and does the monkey. So they're like, do the monkey dance, and he just sort of laughs and walks away. So then the second day rolls
around. Watch the opening to Overman King Gainer if you don't know what the monkey is.
Yes, and, like, the second day comes along, do the monkey dance, he kind of, like, he walks away. They're done. Like, this is their last chance to see him, and they run up to him, like, please, do the monkey. He walks over to them, kind of smiles, and I swear, this is what they said. He kicks him in the shin and just walks away. So I'm like, because I remember hearing about this on M, and I'm like, oh my god, that was actually you?
See, so, Tomino could have confused them for actual monkeys, though. So
yeah, go figure.
Yeah.
Well, there was once that, I guess, reported incident where he took a guy's Gundam model, and when he asked about the new Gundam, and he if he was going to be doing a new Gundam, took it, smashed it to the ground, and said, there's your new Gundam.
Oh, I heard about that. I wonder if that's true.
I love this guy.
I like to think there's, I mean, that and the whole thing with Evangelion, like, at the premiere, Hideaki Anno said something, like, he said that he did this because of him, and I think Tomino reportedly said, don't blame this piece of crap on me.
Oh, and then he went and made Brain Powered. And
yeah, which is...
Yeah, I can do better than that, and that's like the biggest piece of crap in existence.
Oh, God, yeah. See, I think we...
I don't actually know a single human being that has made it through all of Brain Powered.
I got to the first four episodes, and I got the manga, and I thought that would help, maybe, and I'm like, that was the worst mistake ever.
I've never known anyone who's made it through all of Brain Powered.
So I should take it out of my Netflix queue, then?
Brain Powered is such a weird show. It's a show that is made entirely. It was a show that, I mean, the rumor is that Tomino was watching Evangelion, got really pissed off, and said, "I can do better than that." And this Brain Powered show is completely incomprehensible. It's 26 episodes.
I think that's true. Like, I really do believe that.
The only way to understand anything that's going on in the show is to actually read the inserts that come with the DVDs, because everything else makes no sense. And the only reason that the show got made, even got an okay to go, is because Tomino just said, you know, I want to do this show. And so I guess what Tomino says goes, because he's a living legend.
I guess so. I mean, I have to give it props, because we did get some at least decent designs by Mamoru Nagano, but it wasn't worth the price. Yeah, because I think Nagano did Brain Powered, right? I mean, I think he did.
I think he did, but my problem with the designs is that the cockpit is in the crotch, and when everybody sticks their head out, they look like a tiny penis from these robots.
Well, so is Turn A, but, you know, whatever. Be quiet, man. Don't ruin it, okay? all I'm saying is that they were really awesome in Another Century's Episode 3, and that's all that matters. So, because they actually appeared in that game, which is like a cross between Zone of the Enders and Super Robot Wars. If you have not played that game, get it. But I'm trying to think, like, what else could we... There's, like, other notable things by Tomino. I mean, because we covered Zambot.
I like Dumbine.
Dumbine was cool. Don't watch Goretzky's Wing. That was essentially Tomino, like, hey, well, I did these original novels about Bison well, but they didn't have ore battlers in them, because that was devised by the wonderful people at whatever, like Clover and everything. So, like, hey, well, we're gonna do a thing without ore battlers, and let's see what happens. And it's like the worst thing ever. Like, I thought maybe people were just knocking it just because, but I watched it. And I wanted to kill myself, like, right afterwards for believing for a split second that whatever. But I guess he made up for it years later with Wings of Reen, where he essentially did what he set out to do by doing a proper Bison Well story, but with aura battlers that, I guess, match the original designs. But yeah, Dumbline's a fun little show. It's fantasy meets insectoid robots and fairies.
I couldn't deal with Dumbine.
Really?
I tried watching the show, but it's... the thing that I hate about Tomino the most is that he's got awful dialogue, and what he likes to do is he just kind of throws you into these shows and doesn't explain anything. And Dunbine was one where the main character just kind of falls into the middle of this very complicated world, and you're just supposed to figure things out, and if you don't get it, then tough luck.
Yeah, and that really doesn't work at all whatsoever when he did Victory Gundam, which... All I'm going to say, folks, just watch episode... Just start the show with episode 2, otherwise you're going to be confused. Because what he decides to do is he tries to do a clever full circle thing and starts the show with the 4th episode and then does everything else in order. And instead of just cutting and being like, and this is where we are now, no, it's just the same episode all over again with a new beginning. Oh, so don't even start with episode one of Victory Gundam. Just you're better off watching that second.
He's almost like George Lucas in that he's a man who is really big and very powerful, and nobody will tell him no, or nobody will tell him, you know, maybe you shouldn't do it this way, or this is kind of a bad idea. And so he will do these things. Some of them will work out really well, and then some of them are just disasters. And I just wish he wouldn't write. Like, the man cannot write.
But here's the weird thing, though, because you can say that, but was it Crossbone Gundam, which is like, I guess people consider it like the best Gundam manga ever created. It was written by him. Like, everything, like the entire series from start to finish, was all written by Tomino.
It wasn't by Hajime Yatate?
Well, no, sure? It was. Yeah, I'm
because Hajime
positive.
Yatate is always the one that gets credit for writing a lot.
Yeah.
It's usually like Tomino and Hajime Yatate, which is the biggest slap in the face to everyone at Sunrise ever.
Yeah, of course, yeah.
For those who don't know, Hajime Yatate is a pen name for everyone at Sunrise. So the only person that gets credit is Tomino.
Yeah, like Hate Saburo is always like the one credited as like the creator of Sentai, and that's just really everyone at Toei.
Uh-huh.
Something like that. Yeah.
With that in mind, how many of the actual Gundam series did he have a hand in creating, other than being the creator of the original?
Everything up to Victory for the most part. I guess in terms of release, not in chronological order, because I mean he wasn't involved in 0080 or 0083, and you can tell because, like, you know, the plots actually hold up.
He doesn't. Basically, everything after like Char's Counterattack was, I thought, was more his game. And then after Victory, like, didn't he do Victory under protest or something?
He did. Yeah, he did Victory under protest because that was when Sunrise merged with Bandai.
Okay.
And that's why like the Shrike team gets their bitter end of the bullet, because they're introduced solely for fan service, and he's just like no, and just doing checks one after the other. Yeah, because that is the reason why that show was just so depressing.
You know, considering how much he has written, you know, a broken clock is right twice a day, so
yeah.
eventually you got to hit something. And I mean, the man is not incapable of writing, he's just usually pretty bad at it.
He's an acquired taste. He really is an acquired taste. Like, if you can watch the original Gundam trilogy and you stick all the way through and you like it, then stick with him. I honestly recommend something like that. I mean, I
understand. I mean, the Gundam trilogy is the only Gundam that I really love.
Yeah.
Like, well, I think that's the best that Gundam ever got.
Otherwise, I just tell people, just start with Zambot 3, really. Watch Zambot 3, because that's essentially Proto Gundam, and it's Super Robots, and, you know, throw your prejudices of bad animation at the door, because this is pretty freaking awesome. And then just try and go from there and see what happens. But, I mean, he's had some hits, but otherwise, yeah, like you said, Gerald, it's hit or miss.
Yeah, Ideon, for example, is a fine example of how good Tomino can be if he is given the budget of a movie and the time of a movie to tell a story. The Ideon, the second movie, is amazing, I think. The first movie doesn't really make a lot of sense, and so
it's death. It's basically Evangelion death. Yeah.
I don't know if we've answered the question, though. What top threes would we recommend? I would go with definitely Gundam, the original Gundam trilogy, even though I would credit Yoshiakazu Yasuhiko more so with it.
What about you, Mike?
For top three, Zambot's a good one. King Gainer, because it's just ridiculously fun. I kind of want to say Zabungle, because I'm actually watching that right now, and it's a lot of fun. Oh. So, I mean, the Tomino moments are kind of kept down to a minimum. I mean, there are some moments of bad dialogue, but there's a lot of hilarious fourth wall breaking moments. Like, it's like, all right, let me show you the true power of the main character's mech. The field. Or even better, like, how, you know, with how, like, most real robot shows, there aren't any, like, attacks. So all of a sudden, the main character jumps up in the air, and he's like, it's like, certain death, Zabungle punch! And, like, there's the echo and everything. And he just punches a guy in the head. And he's like, I always wanted to say that, jumps away, and the robot blows up. It's a fun show. It is a really cool show. It's essentially Mad Max with giant robots.
And a lot of comedy.
Yeah. If the giant...
Well, actually, Mad Max had a lot of comedy in it, so yes.
Yeah.
Intentional or unintentional. So...
I'm Carl. I run the blog Oguie Maniax at oguiemaniax.wordpress.com. I talk about mostly giant robots. No, not mostly giant robots, but it's one of many topics that I like to discuss on there, which is why I'm here.
So Carl will start. Will join us for the remainder of this podcast. And of course, now we're talking about Go Nagai and Ken Ishikawa. So guys,
I'll have a massive fangasm, which will destroy
his manager. That's the only reason I was invited to here, because I know people. Like, you like Go Nagai, right? I was like, I'm actually a prophet for Go Nagai. I just finished a pilgrimage.
But you didn't know Guy King was also.
I know. That was at the end of the pilgrimage. I'm sorry. I'll have to wait till next May.
What I love about Go Nagai is Go Nagai is the type of person that when you sit around and you're like 12 years old, you're like, oh man, wouldn't it be cool if this existed, or wouldn't it be cool if that existed? And this guy just does that and makes it. Like, he's the type. Every kid at some point in their life sits around and says, oh man, wouldn't it be awesome if there was a superhero who was just naked all the time?
Oh, I was gonna say that one too.
And he just made a show about a superhero that's naked all the time.
And she, like, fought people by rubbing her gooch in their face.
Yeah. And Go Nagai has been doing manga since he was a teenager. In fact, when he was a teenager, he wrote Shameless School, which got burned and was publicly defamed and all that. I mean, this is when you're a teenager. Imagine that you're like 16, 17, and your comic book is now famous around Japan and is being burned.
Pretty much the best day ever.
That's the best ending too, though. Too. I mean, how many people can say that like their entire cast of characters was killed off by the PTA?
Yeah, and I mean, that's not even like touching the giant robot stuff. Like virtually everything Go Nagai like established. He's known as the father of manga, not the god of manga. That's Osamu Tezuka. But Go Nagai is kind of the father of manga because so much that he did just kind of threw a lot of conventions out of the way, oftentimes before these conventions even existed. I was actually at a panel with the manga creator of this manga called Futabukun Change, because there were two people at the convention, and they asked him what is his inspiration. He said, it's Go Nagai, because he was the first guy to say, well, what if I made the villain the main character, and I let the villain win? And what if I made all the dark things in the world the good things, and the light things all the evil things? This was crazy. People hadn't done this stuff before. One of his most famous ones is this long, long-running series called Violence Jack. They made a very silly three-part OAV for it, but the actual manga itself is very, very long, very gruesome. And I joke that Violence Jack did virtually everything before anybody did anything in manga. It's very long, it's very gory, it's got just horrific mutilation and just horrible, horrible things going on. Every single thing you can think of, you turn the page and it's there.
And one of the most random endings of all time, which...
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh,
did you get manga? I won't go into manga, yeah.
Yeah.
I know that there was a thing, like, someone scanned it a while back, translated it. It was like a guide to how, like, when the guy thought up, like, Mazinger Z and Devilman and, like, Violence Jack. And then the entire thing about Violence Jack is like, yeah, what if there was a guy and he was 10 feet tall? He had a knife just as big. Like, that's just the start of the entire series.
Yeah.
He just ran with it.
Yeah.
But really, like, Mazinger, wasn't he? He was, like, in a traffic jam. Like, what if my car was a robot?
Yeah.
And I could just walk to the front of the traffic jam. That was,
and
like,
I could just destroy all these cars.
That's actually the first chapter of the Mazinger manga, is just the robot going on a rampage and taking out highways.
There was an episode of Dilbert like that.
Yeah. Well, didn't he just like just crush the woods? Really, it's just like safe and everything. Because I mean, it, like in the manga, it's like, oh wait, hey Grandpa, how's it going? You're kind of crushed under this rubble, son. Go over here, and here's your robot. Just have fun. And Mazinger goes on a rampage because he just sort of starts it up and isn't told how to stop it.
But its controls are just like a motorcycle.
Yeah, he didn't figure that out.
Wasn't he the first one to put someone into a robot?
Yes, I believe he was. Because before, in like Tetsujin 28, it was the kid would just control it from a remote control.
And then Astro Boy for the obvious reason.
Go Nagai is a pioneer of one other thing. That's taking the word versus and having it mean totally the opposite.
Yes. Well, you can't say that Grandizer versus Great Mazinger.
Yeah, they fought a little bit.
Okay, fought a little bit. My favorite thing is my favorite one though is probably like Mazinger Z versus Devilman.
Yes.
That one, Devilman grows a giant size just to, so they can have the handshake at the end, and they have a motorcycle fight, just because.
A physics-defying motorcycle fight where one guy jumps from like the bottom of a cliff and one guy jumps to the top. Their bikes sort of link up and spin in the air, then bounce off of each other, and they somehow land safely. I need to like get a screen cap of this to really illustrate the point, but I digress.
Basically, Go Nagai is a guy that makes it very... It's very difficult for him to create anything that is not entertaining. It is very hard for him to create anything that is actually
bad.
Good. Well, I mean, good in the terms of some sort of thing that's got, like... I mean, Miyazaki is not going to have any, you know, run for his money in terms of that. But he cannot make anything that's just not entertaining.
Yeah. I think a similar, like... author, a set of authors, is probably Yude Tamago, who do Kinnikuman.
Yeah.
Like, it's that level of, like, what's going on? I don't know.
There's, like, one kind of glaring down note for Go Nagai, at least in my book. Because you guys...
No,
there is. At least to me.
New Cutie Honey.
No, not New Cutie Honey. I actually like the heck out of that. I'm talking about a certain manga he did that was sort of another Mazinger remake. I'm talking about Majin Saga. Have any of you guys ever read that?
I've heard of it, but never seen it.
Okay, so it's this whole thing where he kind of takes the whole Devilman type approach, where it's just like, okay, no, my father, who is still alive, is or who may be alive or is dead, is telling me to put on this mantle. And I put it on. And, oh, guess what? I'm turning huge and into Mazinger itself. Like, I'm Ultraman all of a sudden for some reason. And I'm tearing up buildings and squishing people with my hands and putting the world in red alert. And it's like, you know, Nagai is known for, you know, the violence and everything. But, you know, it's okay. But it just seemed – what kind of turned it off for me, and this may seem like – not like a prude reason – but just kind of a lame reason, is just because, like, Sayaka, like, her only role in that manga is either to be raped or humiliated. Like, I'm serious. Like, her first appearance in the manga, she's being raped. And then later on, it's like, okay, I'm going to control Aphrodite Ace. And it's really just, like, this skimpy, ball-bearing S&M gear that just barely covers her, and she's having to stand out in the middle of the cold and do this whole mobile trace system thing with it. And then later on, she's raped again. So it's just... I don't know. I kind of can't forgive him for that.
Wait.
But,
oh, actually, no. I was thinking of, like, bad Go Nagai series. Wait, did he do Jushin Liger?
Yes, he did.
Oh, okay. Which is not exactly a giant robot. It still involves giants fighting.
Yeah, it's old man, bio armor. If you want to go that route? It's power armor. There you go. That's your cop out.
Okay. Yeah.
That wasn't. I don't know. Jushin like Liger was okay. I mean, it had a cool theme song, but that's pretty much it. I kind of wish that the real Jushin Liger had that kind of giant robot bio armor in the ring, because that would make things a little bit more interesting, and I'd actually pay attention to Japanese wrestling. But ever since they got rid of Tiger Mask, I'm not really, you know, a follower of it. But wow. That's like the really only thing of going to guys I can't forgive him for. But I guess, like, what would you say maybe would be his best work then? I mean, I want. Oh, say it again.
Iron Virgin Jun.
That could be. I want to say the Devilman manga. Really?
Yeah, actually,
I
might vote for that as well. No, I actually have like the Getter Robo G manga, and it is pretty wild.
I can't really. I don't know, like, I can't really count Getter Robo as much, because that was more... I want to say it's more Ishikawa than Go Nagai, because what Ishikawa did is he took Getter Robo and just developed its own, like, mythos with it. Because, you know, they did the original Getter Robo manga, then they did the G manga. I can't remember if it was actually an assistant that did the G manga or not, but from there on out, they did Getter Robo Go, which... don't watch the anime. You're going to punch it. Multiple times. Read the manga, which is pretty awesome.
The song alone is going to drive you away.
If only for the fact that there's an American guy who pilots a mech called... no, the Steel Bomber is in Armageddon, excuse me. But no, he pilots this stealth bomber that turns into a giant robot. But also, he's so racist that if a Japanese guy so much as touches him, he has to blow him away with a shotgun.
Oh Lord.
Yeah, so, but it's really good, it's really awesome, and it makes up for the entire series, but it fleshes out so much stuff, and what he decides to do is take that, he does the Shin Getter manga, he did he did Arc, which is, or Ak, whatever you want to call it, there's a different pronunciation for it, which is never finished, but he just developed this whole Getter sort of mythos and timeline, and it's really kind of amazing. That you know how far he really took it. So like so much the fact that I can't really. I mean, Nagai did play a role in it, but I can't credit Nagai as much as I want to credit Ishikawa. It's sort of like the whole Yamato type thing, where like you want to credit like Matsumoto more than Michizaki.
Yeah.
Did everyone give their picks for favorite Go Nagai series? Or...
I think were we unanimous or?
I'm actually kind of torn because. If I'm thinking of like something that I wanted to say, you know, this is Go Nagai in a nutshell, I would probably show them Black Lion, 45 minutes long, beginning to end.
I feel bad because I've never actually seen that.
Oh my god!
Well, you're getting it now, but
yeah, I know you're gonna like throw the videotape out your door and it's gonna hit me in the back of the head like a boomerang. There we go, yes. Awesome. I'll look forward to it. But I guess in terms of giant robot work for Nagai, are we going to do Nagai or are we going to focus on Nagai Ishikawa?
I don't know.
Okay, because if it's Nagai only, I do want to say, like, just best robot work in general. And this is going to be such a cop-out. Really, it's going to be Grandizer versus Great Mazinger, to be honest. Which... I mean, again, it's just the movie, but it's one of the better versus movies, and it's like right after that we had Final Battle, Great Sea Monster, which is like the definitive.
Yeah, but, I was gonna say I like that one a lot more.
But it's great because you get Koji finally piloting a Mazinger robot again, because like he just gets little UFOs or jet scranders with cockpits and Grandizer. Really, the bitter end of the bullet there.
Okay. I feel like if I could find a English translated copy, Hanabe Bazooka would be my Go Nagai pick because it's the most powerful duo I've ever come across. But unfortunately, I can only find Japanese scans.
All I know is if you don't say Grandizer, we're going to get a very angry Middle Eastern guy responding to this podcast.
Yeah.
I like the Grandizer manga.
Oh yeah, okay. Only for the final chapter where like
yeah, don't say it. That's the only like crazy thing that happens. I was expecting
no, there's
so
crazier
much.
Stuff that happens in that manga, man.
That is total. Then there's more manga that I don't know exists because I found one volume.
Read Astakizer. It's awesome. Okay. It's wrestling with hot rods.
Oh my god.
Coming soon to Series 5 of R5 Central.
Chun Li, huh? Maybe fine as hell, but I'm still taking you down!
I'm going to make you eat those words.
Witness the birth of another fighting game legend. Next time on R5 Central, Street Fighter Special Showdown, the snow covered last match. Don't miss it.
No, I wouldn't want. I'm going to Vegas.
So you want to hear people talk about Japanese cartoons?
You know, anime.
But you think the other anime podcasters just aren't nerdy enough?
Sounds like you need to join forces with the Anime World Order.
Where each week, three self-proclaimed experts offer you reviews.
Of titles both new and classic, news and commentary.
Rants, convention reports, interviews with fandom.
And some hentai and yaoi for good measure.
So search for anime in the iTunes Music Store.
Or visit our website at animeworldorder.com.
Anime World Order, revealing the truth about anime, one podcast at a time.
And I'm going to take this opportunity to move on to the next subject matter. And that, of course, is Shoji Karamori.
Also known as Go Nagai.
How about we just say that Shoji Kawamori was just an alias for Go Nagai,
and we'll just keep talking about Getter Robo.
Yeah, because Ishikawa was cool and much better, but no, Shoji Kawamori, a lot of people may know him from his work on Macross, and also
that's all you should know.
It's all you should know about Kawamori, because it's just after that he kind of got the idea that, hey, maybe I should direct anime, and that was like the beginning of the downward spiral.
I haven't been burned yet, because I haven't really had a problem with the couple of things I've watched.
Watch
so far,
the Aquarion movie, John. Watch the Aquarion movie.
I think it's that I'm appreciating Aquarion in like that it's just such a train wreck.
See, I feel like it is the most intentional train wreck I've ever seen. It's
I can't appreciate it. I mean, I like the Japanese Spider-Man TV series, okay?
Well, like, I've only seen, like, two episodes at this point, but it's, like, the second episode, some guy did, like, a flaming dropkick and got blocked with some guy blowing kisses at him. It was amazing. I can't hate something like that. Okay.
I mean, there were some shiny moments there, but otherwise, I'm sorry, just after that Aquarium movie, I'm like, I have to write off the entire series. It's like... Okay. It's like how I can
see,
never watch The Matrix. Yeah.
And it sounded awesome.
Oh, okay. I see. I've never seen the Aquarian movie. I watched like half the series. And
a robot gives birth in the middle of a fight and then has a miscarriage.
That's amazing.
Oh, God.
That sounds like Zammed or something.
That's all I need to know about it, because all of a sudden it's just like some person gets their arm hacked off and then this robot gets pregnant in the middle of the fight because Aquarion is so powerful, and then they have a stillbirth or whatever. It's so bad. And
Shoji Kawamori is another one of these guys where people just can't tell him no. And
yeah, actually, I don't know why.
He did this series. I mentioned it already. I don't know. I don't think we were recording then. Earth Girl Arjuna. This was 6 years ago or so, and it's a horrifically terrible series, and it's Kawamori sitting around saying, oh my god, the Earth is going to hell. We're damaging the Earth. I'm going to make an anime series all about this, full of misinformation about the environment. And
there's
so
actually a image macro with him like holding a bong and describing the synopsis of Arjuna at a convention. But yeah, continue, Gerald. Yeah. I give up.
So anyway, I think the whole point is that Kawamori is a much better mecha designer. I think he designed the mechas for Eureka 7, like all those like sky surfing robots.
Yeah,
he did the mecha design for a lot of shows.
Yeah, that's the best thing that's the thing that he's the best at, and that's the only thing that he should be allowed to do.
It's like him, Ichiro Itano, like who else is there that should just stick to what they do best and not try to direct anything?
Masami Obari.
Sami Obari, yeah, he's a better mecha designer than he is a director. I mean, although, then again, some people say that Angel Blade was the greatest anime of all time. But
I did enjoy Fatal Fury, actually.
That
so...
was fantastic, yeah.
Yes.
All right, and with that, we're going to go into our last topic, and we're going to pretty much mention any series or creator or show that we haven't mentioned so far. So why don't we start off with Taduo, how do you say it? Let's start there.
He's like the unsung hero of mecha, I guess.
Yeah. It really just because he died so shortly after changing mech anime forever.
And
people just
like,
don't
who was that mass man anyway, like that kind of he's responsible for the Romance Robot trilogy, three really awesome shows, well depending on who you talk to, Combatler V, Voltus 5, and Toshio Daimos, which I think Daimos and Voltus 5 are shown in the Philippines. Some people like to say Voltus 5 was responsible for this great revolution out there, but whatever. Not exactly true, but it definitely proved that you could not only do a show that it was designed to hawk toys, but you could actually have a plot.
Yeah, I know that he and Tomino worked a lot together, and so I think they influenced each other tremendously if you watch the shows that came out at around the same time.
Yeah, I like to say that like Zambot 3 was sort of like Tomino's thesis from the trilogy, where it's like...
Yeah.
Maybe it's possible that you can do a plot, but let's take it and make that a little darker. as opposed to like the traditional like cliches of super robots now, that we have now.
And the funny, like, have you guys ever seen a Raiden, like the original?
Yes.
Raiden? Like the interesting thing about Raiden is that the first half was directed by Tomino, and the second half is directed by Nagahama, and you can see exactly where it divides. But you can also see that it's an interesting show because it has like a Tomino beginning and a Nagahama ending mashed together, rather than like the typical Nagahama beginning, which is like, I got a robot. You want kids want to pilot it? Sure. Oh, yeah. One big influence that I think Nagahama had on the giant robot genre is that all of the series they worked on had like proto-char Osnables.
Yes.
Like, all these like suave blonde dudes who are like...
All voiced by the same guy.
He almost seemed to introduce this concept of the likable protagonist, or the protagonist that was not just evil for the sake of being evil. There was something...
antagonist.
Yeah. You're right, the antagonist. I use protagonist. Thanks for catching that.
I mean, likable protagonist is also kind of hard to find in these series sometimes. But...
Yes, yeah, you're right. Yeah, the likable antagonist.
That's... Great, Mazinger! I'm sorry. I'm sorry, I hate Tetsuya Tsurugi so freaking much. If only for the fact that he's a whiny brat by the end of the series. But yeah, let's go on about Nagahama.
Okay, so...
Definitely one of the unsung heroes of mech anime.
Now, what I want to do right now is from each person on our panel, I want you to give them, I would say, you know, 3 to 5 shows that would get them started in the right direction to be as well versed as you when it comes to these shows. Because just speaking for someone that's outside of the loop of giant robots, there's a lot of things that could possibly go over people's heads. But at the same time, you know, if you're watching some of these shows, you can kind of get a better understanding of what everyone's talking about. So I want to start with Mike, and then just go down the line and just give me 3 to 5 shows that people should watch that would get them interested and won't turn them away from.
Yeah, when it's like so intimidating and everything.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, because I was just trying to think of that like right now. Voltus 5 would be a good one, because I guess if you want to kind of describe it to an outsider, it's a Voltron with an actual plot, if that's even possible. Gunbuster, because the fact it's just the animation is just gorgeous. I mean, even though the title robot doesn't really show up until like, you know, what could be considered the last volume, it's still pretty much worth it. Gosh, I'm probably gonna steal away all these other really great shows because I know someone's gonna say Gal Gagar at one point. So, but that's a divided one, really. Because now it's like off the top of my head. Just the Brave series in general is a good one. I mean, I can't really recommend definitive shows because it really just kind of depends. I mean, I could just say like, oh, watch all these cool shows in the 80s and it really won't make sense. But Votums is also a good one too, and that's like,
very good. Votums,
yes, amazing series. Hard sci-fi.
The thing is that with Votums, the Votums themselves, they might as well be, they could be anything. They could be tanks, they could be whatever, but they're just kind of this, it's the response to Gundam.
I guess Laser might be a good one too if you want to do like the whole Cold War in space. But yeah, like I said, I can't really give you a definitive list. Mm-hmm. I can throw as many shows out as possible, but it's just really hard, like in a kind of a short time, to like just kind of like give you an ironed out list.
I would normally recommend Go Donner, but that's not going to fly for any beginner ever.
Yeah, that's very much one for hardcore fans.
Yeah, so. And
or the desperate.
I'll say Gold Lighton because I can, but no, don't take that seriously. let's say for beginners, I think the original Gundam trilogy, it's long, and it can turn off a lot of people with its old animation, but I think it's a pretty good pick. I like Rika 7 quite a bit, and I think it actually brought in a lot of people who normally didn't like giant robot shows. And it has a very solid plot, very solid characters, and it has a lot of throwbacks to old mecha series as well. So if they start exploring that, they can maybe kind of get into it more. For a third one, it's so tricky to like pick any, just because like so many people approach it from so many different angles. Like, I know a lot of people would get turned off by Votoms immediately, for example.
Yes.
Even though I like it, but
it's a total sham.
Actually, just maybe original Macross. I think that's a good one. Because I think that it's a show that, you know, you don't like. A lot of people might claim that you need nostalgia to watch it, but I watched it pretty late, like a lot, many years after it appeared in Japan or America, and I was instantly hooked. So,
okay, I'm going to approach this as if someone were asking me at a convention, what should I watch for giant robot shows, and I've never watched anything. So I'll try to approach it from that angle. If you're going to get someone to watch something, it can't be a very long show right off the bat. So I'm going to say start off with Macross Plus. It is 4 episodes long. It's fantastic. And it stands very well by itself.
What about the movie edition?
I have never seen the movie edition, actually.
Okay,
and
yeah.
I do know the movie edition does some things better and some things worse. But I would recommend the OAVs because it just gives them the taste of giant robot shows.
Mm.
Then I would say go into Giant Robo. Giant Robo is longer, so it's a bit more of a commitment. But there is so many good things about that show that I think, regardless of who they are, they will find something to like in it. Then I think from there they need to get into Gren Lagann. Now, I'm not a big fan of Gren Lagann, but a lot of people like Gren Lagann because there is so much in it for so many different people. And it's not especially a regular giant robot show, but I think for someone who is just getting into it, it's a very good place to go. Then I think they need to watch the original Gundam series, because I think only then could you get them to watch something that's older, if they are actually getting into giant robots at this point.
Mm.
And then I think that they need to end it all off. I really want to put Pat Labor in there, but I don't really know.
Oh, God, yeah, I completely forgot about Pat Labor.
I don't really know where Pat Labor fits, but I feel that they need to watch Pat Labor, but I feel they need to end this all off with, after maybe watching those and maybe a couple of others like Gao Gaigar and such, they need to end it off with watching Gunbuster. Because Gunbuster is kind of the culmination, in my opinion, of all of the cliches of giant robot shows and all of the uniqueness of giant robot shows, and completely thrown about, turned around, and put out and made new again. And that I think, if they can get through those initial shows that are really, they're giant robot shows in name, but they're more character series, then I think you can get them into series that are more about the giant robot. That was probably not really a top five. It was kind of a mishmash of things, but it's a road.
It's kind of difficult because I haven't seen as much as the other people on the panel. And so I'm going to suggest the things that are helping me get into the genre, because I'm just starting to watch giant robot shows now after being turned away by when I started getting into anime by accidentally buying Knights of Ramune and, I don't know, trying to watch Gundam and not understanding what was going on. And so what's bringing me back first was Get a Robo.
Mm-hmm.
And what I did on my podcast was I suggested people watch Shin Getter versus Neo Getter because it's only 4 episodes long, and it's just as crazy as anything else I've seen. And it actually worked for the most part. I got a handful of people sending me emails asking me what else they should watch, and so
that's a really good place to start for Go Nagai stuff, Go Nagai giant robot stuff in general, I think, because it's short,
yeah,
and it's to the point.
That's the majority of it.
Would just be too intimidating.
Yeah, well, the majority of my giant robot stuff has been Go Nagai, so
like, I don't think you can throw, like, Mazinkaiser at them as the first thing that they ever see, because Mazinkaiser
that was next.
But I think Mazinkaiser would be a good second, though, because it's more boiled down Go Nagai.
I guess it depends, really. I mean, if it is a guy, maybe they'll get into, like, the action. But, like,
Clarissa's
going to
come out of the sky and punch you in the face. But,
No! Clarissa, if you're listening to this, I didn't mean it like that. I don't know. Come on, admit it. I mean, most guys out there, it's like, there is that inert desire, just if it explodes, I'm going to get into it right away. So I think, I don't know, that's where I'm sort of iffy about that. I mean, I would think Mazinkaiser would be like maybe a tie for first. But that's just me.
Well, I mean, Texas Mac is hard to beat. So
true.
But I guess we already said Mazinkaiser. I guess if you enjoy Mazinkaiser, then move on to Shin Mazinger, because you'll at least be familiar with the characters, sort of.
Hmm.
Because that was what I watched next. I kind of watched them at the same time, to be completely honest. I don't know if I'm ready to go back and watch the original Mazinger yet, because
nobody,
I watched a couple. I watched a few of the movies, and I wasn't ready for it. So
Shin Mazinger is a rough one, too, because, I mean, there's plenty of hardcore fans who have a hard time with that show.
Yeah, I guess it really... See, I really like Imagawa and what he's doing with that. And a lot of people are getting on it because it's, like, slow. At least that's what Mike is telling me. And frankly, I didn't notice. I like just the visual. Like, I called it visual poetry on my show because a lot of it seems to be what's going on in the character's head. Like, they had Baron Asher running on the water. But no, it was just running to dropkick Mazinger.
That's so, very beatnik poetry right there. Just
yeah, because people are kind of impatient these days. I mean, because I think it just comes the attitude of the times. I mean, because we can have everything now, that yeah. We've got to have everything kind of go along this route or else you're going to lose interest. And you're just sort of like, bored now, turn off the TV, go for somewhere else.
Well, I mean, it's weird in that there's a lot happening in every episode, but in 6 episodes, they're still on one day.
Yeah.
That's, or is it 7 episodes? They're still
the
on one day.
Super Robot version of 24.
Someone had to point that out to me, though, which is why I think that unless you... I got so caught up in it that I frankly did not notice at all. And
yeah.
I was like on the edge of my seat waiting for the next episode. But, God, what would I... I've only seen one episode of it, but I really, really like Brave Exkaiser.
It is a good Brave series.
I think it wasn't at the first one.
Yeah.
Because, like, people keep telling me to watch Gao Gaigar, and I keep seeing YouTube videos and...
Gagagar is one of the most difficult sells ever because you're literally saying, okay, just watch 26 episodes of a mediocre giant robot show, and then you're going to get the greatest thing in the entire world. And
yeah.
That's
yeah.
a hell of a lot to ask. That's a hell
yeah,
of a
I mean,
lot
didn't
to
you eat, like, even IM me at one point and try to, like, figure out what, like, the definitive, like, pre-second half episodes would be?
We're watching it at my anime meetings, and we've got a lot of girls there, and... Some of them do not want to sit through a lot of the series. They want to watch the core of the first part of the series and then everything in the second.
Yeah.
Because it's a hard, hard sell.
But, yeah, I don't know. I really, aside from the Go Nagai stuff, I really have not watched nearly as much. That's what I'm doing this summer.
And we will hold you to that.
A few shows that I've started to watch, I would even say in the last couple of weeks, I finished the Gundam trilogy. And I thought the third movie, like the last, I want to say, 30 minutes was extremely intense.
Yes.
And
yeah.
I wasn't expecting that. I the first two I kind of finished in real time in the sense that I watched it without stopping. The third one, I was a little distracted. But after like the 45 minutes to the end of the movie, I was kind of stopped everything I was doing and just kind of narrowed in on the series and did a lot of shocking things that I wasn't really used to, but you guys are probably used to by now watching all these different series. Giant Robo, I'm starting to watch. I'm not that far into it to say whether or not I like it, but so far so good. I'm starting to watch New Getter Robo. For some reason, I thought that was recommended to me. I don't think it was, now that I think about it.
I probably told you to do it.
So, I'm watching, I Netflix New Getter Robo for some reason thinking it was Giant Robo. And I actually was talking to Mike yesterday. And
that's why you were like, crap.
Yeah, I had the Netflix in my hand. I'm like, all right, let me watch this before the podcast. And then... I was talking to you, and you're like, no, it's Giant Robo. I'm like, shit. And then I kind of, like, left and bought and went out and bought Giant Robo that same night. So
decent price, too. I was really surprised by that.
So, that's where I am right now. And, of course, I've watched some series in the past, but I've never really, like, sat down and said, okay, this series was created by this creator. And this, you know, I watched, like, G Gundam, I really enjoyed. I watched it on its run in Cartoon Network. And with that said, I'd like to thank Gerald from AWO, John Paul from Fight Bait Anime Podcast, and Mike Dent from R5 Central for joining us on this episode of the Anime 3000 panel. We're gearing up for a brand new episode that's going to come out towards the end of the season where we're going to answer some questions from the listeners. And the way that you can actually become part of the podcast is by calling us on our brand new number and leaving a voicemail. So you can call us at 954-903-0811. That's 954-903-0811. And leave us a message. Let us know what you think about the podcast. Ask a question and we'll pull together a nice panel and answer your questions on a future episode. So, with that said, we'll see you next week.